In a forgotten corner of the Manukau at Atuatoa lies an ancient stone garden, the last global milestone of mankind.
And then you go up there and you see the Manukau heads, and I immediately imagine our waka, Tainui waka, coming through there.
Legend has it, 8 centuries ago, Pānya Newton's people were the pioneers. They settled right here on the final frontier, Aotearoa.
This area is important to the history of Auckland and New Zealand. We're talking about the first humans to ever arrive after the Great Migration.
But now another migration is on the way, one Pānya is determined to fight.
I'm going to do everything that I can to protect and preserve this land.
Could this be the next bastion point?
It very well could be.
Whether you leave peacefully and with dignity, or whether you are forcibly removed, is a decision for you to make.
Bastion Point, a flashpoint in the 70s over a government plan to develop prime Auckland land, land Māori claimed as their own.
How much longer must we talk, must we ask? How much bloody longer?
Again, another collision course is looming.
It would be easy to dismiss these rock walls as simply a pile of stones, but carbon dating and archaeology proves they were put here by human hand hundreds of years ago. Now, they're protected, but right next door, just beyond that white flag, is a council-approved plan to build nearly 500 new houses. And according to conservationists, that's like throwing up a block of flats right next to Stonehenge.
Stonehenge is going to look pretty wretched with a bunch of houses next to it, similarly with the Stonefield Reserve.
David Vert, archaeologist, has studied this settlement for over 30 years. Now he fears for its future.
What we've got is probably one of the most important archaeological structures in Auckland. We're walking through the middle of an extremely large whare. And this house was built hundreds of years ago, sitting up on top of this lava ridge. And what we can see on either side is we can see that's the front wall there, side walls, and the back wall.
This is what archaeologists believe it would have looked like, a whare that sheltered generations of families over hundreds of years.
Extraordinary view, dominating position. This is big, isn't it, for Māori?
It is. It's what archaeologists used to refer to as a chief's house. It's of that dimension.
Carbon dating indicates Māori may well have admired this view 200 years before Columbus discovered America.
There are dates dating back to the 13th century, so we're talking Magna Carta, we're talking Crusades. And at that stage, there are people living on this land.
Once, most of Auckland looked like this. Back in the 30s, archaeologist Jeff Fairfield photographed Auckland's lost world from a biplane.
He could see amazing garden systems from his aeroplane in these little walls that go across gullies, stones stacked onto outcrops to form shelter for the gardens.
What happened to all these ruins?
We just quarry them. I mean, it's a bit like sort of, well, okay, we'll keep the big pyramid and the second biggest, but all the rest of them are going.
Leaving the last 100 hectares at Aotearoa saved as a council reserve.
That's protected. That's enough, isn't it? Mm. What more do you want?
Well, the problem now is that there's nothing else left. There used to be thousands and thousands of hectares of this sort of landscape. This is the last bit.
Now, white banners form a line of defence around the stone fields.
We've marked out the boundaries with white flags because they're a symbolic sign of peace and protest.
So with hundreds of homes on private land next door, objectors fear that will bring more people onto the reserve. And as they see it, even child's play could knock over stones loosely stacked hundreds of years ago.
People climbing on it, having no respect or knowledge about the significance of this area, going into these spaces.
If we put another 1,000 people right on its boundary, it's going to need a hell of a lot of attention in terms of infrastructure from the council who now manage it.
All this on land, Pānya believes, was wrongfully taken from local Māori.
This land was confiscated in 1863 because the iwi and the people of this land wouldn't pledge their allegiance to the crown.
After that, European farmers took over this land that had been cultivated very nicely for the last few hundred years.
After land confiscation came quarries, later the foreshore polluted with the Mangere sewage treatment ponds. As Pānya sees it, housing development is just the latest threat.
Us as a people here have already suffered enough for the greater good of Auckland.
Now there's also the question, what lies under the proposed development site itself?
We have burial sites that are on that land, and within it we have lava caves, which is also special sites of significance for us.
You have this little lost world where things have been preserved in time. And it seems really unfortunate that part of the story is about to disappear.
After the break, what Fletcher is planning to put up next door.
We think that there's a great opportunity to provide housing and history, and that's what we think that Stonefield is really about.
And where the battle lines are drawn.
We're prepared to escalate our action to occupy this land.
Is this going to happen?
Yes, it's going to happen.
Ihumātao. Ever heard of it?
When you say the word Ihumātao, they don't even know where it is. They think it's in some other part of the country, not in Mangere.
That's right, Mangere, as in Gateway to Auckland.
It's just down the road, down the corner. And that's how I explain it to them, and they think, what? Never been there.
And that's just how the locals like it.
Don't really care that much because that means they don't come out here.
But Ihumātao, population just 294, hides a special secret. Because for centuries, it's been home to the guardians of those stone fields at Atuatoa. While Auckland's population explodes all around, the stone fields and the settlement have slumbered just half an hour from Queen Street. Until now.
We think that there's a great opportunity to provide housing and history, and that's what we think that Stonefields is really about.
And here at Wattle Downs is an example of what Fletcher plans to build next door to those Stonefields.
And I think that how it's directly relevant is that it's a great streetscape. It's also a good community that we've created, and that's taken time to be able to establish.
What about Fletcher's Steve Evans believes this will blend in nicely with Ihumātao's history.
You've got some smaller as well as larger double stories, and again over this side you've got smaller single story houses as well. So the philosophy of building a community is all about a range of houses that you provide, a range of homes, and make that experience of the community very visible as well as functional.
So then the maximum number of houses there would be 480?
That's correct. We would envisage that that's about 1,000 people in the new community.
And that supplies just a fraction of Auckland's desperate need for housing.
We are 40,000 homes short of what Auckland needs now.
That's fine, say objectors, but not at Ihumātao. On the edge of the development block, protesters drop tons of concrete blocks. The message, they could be here to stay.
Today you are all witnessing this historic event.
That this could well be a long fight.
This land is so precious that we're prepared to escalate our action to occupy this land.
Occupation. It's got the backing of Mangere's local MP.
I think that's what we're left with. We're not against the development of land per se because we need more housing, but there are far better areas for developing houses. And so if need be, then that's what needs to happen.
So a lawmaker advocating possibly people breaking the law, are you comfortable with that?
When the law is wrong, then I think it's people are left with no other choice but to respond.
Ihumātao is not only a Māori issue, it's not a Mangere issue or a community issue, but this is a New Zealand issue.
Why the protest?
The protest is clearly about the significance of the stone fields next to our site. We absolutely realise the importance of the stone fields next to us, and we think that our design caters for that.
The concern is from archaeologists that you are building over old occupied areas. Who knows what's under there?
We have engaged our own archaeologists. We've actually done ground penetrating radar of the site as well. So we know exactly where the underground caves are, and we're committing not to build over them. We know that there is a midden. We've identified that as part of that ongoing engagement that we've had with iwi. So we're clearly not building in any of the areas where that is the case.
Can you be sure? Because the archaeologists say they don't know.
And we will have an archaeologist with us as we go through this process.
I made a mistake. And since I realised that mistake, I've done everything I can to try and put it right.
Auckland councillor Cathy Casey regretting she voted to approve a development that looked fine on paper.
We saw EOK, that's why it was recommended by staff. You know, the EWI had signed off and there were no issues sufficient to bring to council's attention.
And how many developments were you considering that day?
Well, there was over 80.
That's 80 special housing areas pushed through under the government's new fast-track legislation.
The process for establishing special housing areas, it was done behind closed doors, still in confidence until it went to the minister. So really there's no public input until the end of the process.
Only later did she learn there was a split among local Māori. She had a final option, give the objectors one last say.
The residents of Ihumātao and our wider community were unaware that this area had been established as an SHA until we saw pigs being surveyed on the land.
It was apparent while the Marae Committee supported the development, others did not.
And what was patently obvious here was a mismatch between the people I saw, there must have been a couple of hundred, and the negotiation which had been done on their behalf by their elders. Now that's an issue for them, but most definitely all was not well at Ihumātao.
In their defence, elders argued they negotiated the best deal possible for a development they couldn't stop.
The only reason we began to talk with Fletchers was that to change things, there needed to be a law change.
One concession won by the elders, between the development and the stone fields, an 80-metre buffer zone. Despite the opposition, the council stood by its decision.
On all of our developments, we have people that support and don't support our development. The Marae has given us their voice of support, as they have through that SHA process.
Were you aware, though, that within the iwi there was opposition?
You will always get those that won't particularly like what we're doing, so yes, we were aware.
Did you inform the council of that opposition?
We didn't apply for the SHA, we supported the SHA process. So it's not up to us to make those comments through to council, it's council's. I don't think you ever get to a position where everyone agrees. I think that if you look at any development throughout Auckland, you're always going to find more than one person that doesn't agree with what developers do.
You know, I think it will actually be another bastion point, and I'll be right there shoulder to shoulder with them. This land is precious to them, there's no question. And it shouldn't be built on.
Well, Bastion Point is a completely different scenario, of course, because Bastion Point was a piece of public land. This isn't. This is a private land. It's been in private hands for 150 years. Council have approved now 6 years ago, 5 years ago, for housing to be on this piece of land. And we think we're the right responsible developer to turn what is already an approved process into reality.
And what would be the overall value of the project?
It's in the hundreds of millions.
Hundreds of millions of dollars.
Correct.
Is this going to happen?
Yes, it's going to happen.
Not if Cathy Casey can help it. Although appeals have run out, she's hoping for a political solution.
The issue is whether council's prepared to put some money up to fix this.
Do you think they should?
Me, yes, of course. We made a mistake. Mistakes cost money, you know, and Fletcher as the developer has, you know, presumably expended quite a bit of money in their process to get this far. And we owe it to them to give them somewhere else that's equal, if not better, than what they have now. But this piece of land shouldn't be the one they build on. It shouldn't be.
To aid the campaign, Pania Newton has yet another strategy. She just got a law degree.
For us as Māori, we say to know where you're going, you must know where you've come from. And so the land and this environment motivates me and inspires me to succeed. Having a law degree will assist me in trying to protect and preserve this land.
In her opinion, there's a lot to defend.
Enough is enough. How much more do we have to suffer, and how much more history and heritage and culture must we lose for the progress of Auckland?